Chapter 5 of The People of the Black Circle by Robert E. Howard. Chapter 5 The Black Stallion. The sun was well up when Yasmina awoke. She did not start and stare blankly, wondering where she was. She awoke with full knowledge of all that had occurred. Her supple limbs were stiff from her long ride, and her firm flesh seemed to feel the contact of the muscular arm that had borne her so far. She was lying on a sheepskin, covering a pallet of leaves on a hard-beaten dirt floor. A folded sheepskin coat was under her head, and she was wrapped in a ragged cloak. She was in a large room, the walls of which were crudely but strongly built of uncut rocks, plastered with sun-baked mud. Heavy beams supported a roof of the same kind, in which showed a trapdoor up to which led a ladder. There were no windows in the thick walls, only loopholes. There was one door, a sturdy bronze affair that must have been looted from some Vignon border tower. Opposite it was a wide opening in the wall with no door, but several strong wooden bars in place. Beyond them, Yasmina saw a magnificent black stallion munching a pile of dried grass. The building was fort, dwelling place, and stable in one. At the other end of the room, a girl in the vest and baggy trousers of a hill woman squatted beside a small fire, cooking strips of meat on an iron grid laid over blocks of stone. There was a sooty cleft in the wall a few feet from the floor, and some of the smoke found its way out there. The rest floated in blue wisps about the room. The hill girl glanced at Yasmina over her shoulder, displaying a bold, handsome face, and then continued her cooking. Voices boomed outside, then the door was kicked open and Conan strode in. He looked more enormous than ever, with the morning sunlight behind him, and Yasmina noted some details that had escaped her the night before. His garments were clean and not ragged. The broad Bakhariot girdle that supported his knife in its ornamented scabbard would have matched the robes of a prince, and there was a glint of fine Turanian mail under his shirt. "Your captive is awake, Conan," said the Wazuli girl, and he grunted, strode up to the fire, and swept the strips of mutton off into a stone dish. The squatting girl laughed up at him with some spicy jest, and he grinned wolfishly, and hooking a toe under her haunches, tumbled her sprawling onto the floor. She seemed to derive considerable amusement from this bit of rough horseplay, but Conan paid no more heed to her. Producing a great hunk of bread from somewhere, with a copper jug of wine, he carried the lot to Yasmina, who had risen from her pallet and was regarding him doubtfully. "Rough fare for a Devi girl, but our best," he grunted. "It will fill your belly at least." He set the platter on the floor, and she was suddenly aware of a ravenous hunger. Making no comment, she seated herself cross-legged on the floor, and taking the dish in her lap, she began to eat, using her fingers, which were all she had in the way of table utensils. After all, adaptability is one of the tests of true aristocracy. Conan stood looking down at her, his thumbs hooked in his girdle. He never sat cross-legged after the Eastern fashion. "Where am I?" she asked abruptly. "In the hut of Yar Afzal, the chief of the Kurum Wazulis," he answered. "Afghulistan lays a good many miles further on to the west. We'll hide here a while. The Kassatriyas are beating up the hills for you. Several of their squads have been cut up by the tribes already." "What are you going to do?" she asked.
"Keep you until Chunder Shan is willing to trade back my 7 cow thieves," he grunted. "Women of the Wazuli are crushing ink out of skoki leaves, and after a while you can write a letter to the governor."
A touch of her old imperious wrath shook her, as she thought how maddeningly her plans had gone awry, leaving her captive of the very man she had plotted to get into her power. She flung down the dish with the remains of her meal and sprang to her feet, tense with anger. "I will not write a letter. If you do not take me back, they will hang your 7 men, and 1,000 more besides." The Wazuli girl laughed mockingly. Conan scowled, and then the door opened, and Yar Afzal came swaggering in. The Wazuli chief was as tall as Conan, and of greater girth, but he looked fat and slow beside the hard compactness of the Cimmerian. He plucked his red-stained beard and stared meaningly at the Wazuli girl, and that wench rose and scurried out without delay. Then Yar Afzal turned to his guest.
"The damnable people murmur, Conan," quoth he. "They wish me to murder you and take the girl to hold for ransom. They say that anyone can tell by her garments that she is a noble lady. They say, why should the Afghuli dogs profit by her, when it is the people who take the risk of guarding her?"
"Lend me your horse," said Conan. "I'll take her and go."
"Pshh!" boomed Yar Afzal. "Do you think I can't handle my own people? I'll have them dancing in their shirts if they cross me. They don't love you or any other outlander, but you saved my life once, and I will not forget it. Come out, though, Conan. A scout has returned."
Conan hitched at his girdle and followed the chief outside. They closed the door after them, and Yasmina peeped through a loophole. She looked out on a level space before the hut. At the farther end of that space there was a cluster of mud and stone huts, and she saw naked children playing among the boulders, and the slim, erect women of the hills going about their tasks. Directly before the chief's hut, a circle of hairy, ragged men squatted, facing the door. Conan and Yar Afzal stood a few paces before the door, and between them and the ring of warriors another man sat cross-legged. This one was addressing his chief in the harsh accents of the Wazuli, which Yasmina could scarcely understand, though as part of her royal education she had been taught the languages of Iranistan and the kindred tongues of Gulistan.
"I talked with a Dagozai who saw the riders last night," said the scout. "He was lurking near when they came to the spot where we ambushed the Lord Conan. He overheard their speech. Chandrashan was with them. They found the dead horse, and one of the men recognized it as Conan's. Then they found the man Conan slew, and knew him for a Wazuli. It seemed to them that Conan had been slain, and the girl taken by the Wazuli, so they turned aside from their purpose of following to Afghulistan. But they did not know from which village the dead man was come, and we left no trail a Kshatriya could follow. So they rode to the nearest Wazuli village, which was the village of Jugra, and burnt it and slew many of the people. But the men of Kojor came upon them in darkness and slew some of them and wounded the governor. So the survivors retired down the Zaibar in the darkness before dawn, but they returned with reinforcements before sunrise. And there has been skirmishing and fighting in the hills all morning. It is said that a great army is being raised to sweep the hills about the Zaibar. The tribes are whetting their knives and laying ambushes in every pass from here to Gorasha Valley. Moreover, Karim Shah has returned to the hills." A grunt went around the circle, and Yasmina leaned closer to the loophole at the name she had begun to mistrust. "Where went he?"
demanded Yar Afzal. "The Dagozai did not know. With him were 30 Irakzai of the lower villages. They rode into the hills and disappeared."
"These Irakzai are jackals that follow a lion for crumbs," growled Yar Afzal. "They have been lapping up the coins Karim Shah scatters among the border tribes to buy men like horses. I like him not, for all he is our kinsman from Iranistan."
"He's not even that," said Conan. I know him of old. He's an Hyrkanian, a spy of Yestergird's. If I catch him, I'll hang his hide to a tamarisk.
But the Kshatriyas, clamored the men in the semicircle. Are we to squat on our haunches until they smoke us out? They will learn at last in which Wazuli village the wench is held. We are not loved by the Zaibari. They will help the Kshatriyas hunt us out.
Let them come, grunted Yar Afzal. We can hold the defiles against a host. One of the men leaped up and shook his fist at Conan.
Are we to take all the risks while he reaps the rewards? He howled. Are we to fight his battles for him?
With a stride, Conan reached him and bent slightly to stare full into his hairy face. The Cimmerian had not drawn his long knife, but his left hand gripped the scabbard, jutting the hilt suggestively forward. I ask no man to fight my battles, he said softly. Draw your blade if you dare, you yapping dog. The Wazuli stared back, snarling like a cat.
Dare to touch me, and here are 50 men to rend you apart, he screeched. What? Roared Yar Afzal, his face purpling with wrath. His whiskers bristled, his belly swelled with his rage. Are you chief of Khurum? Do the Wazulis take orders from Yar Afzal or from a low-bred cur?
The man cringed before his invincible chief, and Yar Afzal, striding up to him, seized him by the throat and choked him until his face was turning black. Then he hurled the man savagely against the ground and stood over him with his tulwar in his hand.
Is there anyone who questions my authority? He roared, and his warriors looked down sullenly as his bellicose glare swept their semicircle. Yar Afzal grunted scornfully and sheathed his weapon with a gesture that was the apex of insult. Then he kicked the fallen agitator with a concentrated vindictiveness that brought howls from his victim.
Get down the valley to the watchers on the heights and bring word if they have seen anything, commanded Yar Afzal, and the man went, shaking with fear and grinding his teeth with fury.
Yar Afzal then seated himself ponderously on a stone, growling in his beard. Conan stood near him, legs braced apart, thumbs hooked in his girdle, narrowly watching the assembled warriors. They stared at him sullenly, not daring to brave Yar Afzal's fury, but hating the foreigner as only a hillman can hate.
Now listen to me, you sons of nameless dogs, while I tell you what the Lord Conan and I have planned to fool the Kshatriyas.
The boom of Yar Afzal's bull-like voice followed the discomfited warrior as he shrunk away from the assembly. The man passed by the cluster of huts, where women who had seen his defeat laughed at him and called stinging comments, and hastened on along the trail that wound among spurs and rocks toward the valley head. Just as he rounded the first turn that took him out of sight of the village, he stopped short, gaping stupidly. He had not believed it possible for a stranger to enter the valley of Khurum without being detected by the hawk-eyed watchers along the heights. Yet a man sat cross-legged on a low ledge beside the path, a man in a camel-hair robe and a green turban.
The Wazuli's mouth gaped for a yell, and his hand leaped to his knife-hilt,
but at that instant his eyes met those of the stranger, and the cry died in his throat. His fingers went limp. He stood like a statue, his own eyes glazed and vacant. For minutes the scene held motionless. Then the man on the ledge drew a cryptic symbol in the dust of the rock with his forefinger. The Wazuli did not see him place anything within the compass of that emblem.
but presently something gleamed there, a round, shiny black ball that looked like polished jade. The man in the green turban took this up and tossed it to the Wazuli, who mechanically caught it. "Carry this to Yar Afzal," he said, and the Wazuli turned like an automaton and went back along the path, holding the black jade ball in his outstretched hand. He did not even turn his head to the renewed jeers of the women as he passed the huts. He did not seem to hear. The man on the ledge gazed after him with a cryptic smile. A girl's head rose above the rim of the ledge, and she looked at him with admiration and a touch of fear that had not been present the night before. "Why did you do that?" she asked. He ran his fingers through her dark locks, caressingly. "Are you still dizzy from your flight on the horse of air that you doubt my wisdom?" he laughed. "As long as Yar Afzal lives, Conan will bide safe among the Wazuli fighting men. Their knives are sharp, and there are many of them. What I plot will be safer, even for me, than to seek to slay him and take her from among them. It takes no wizard to predict what the Wazuli will do, and what Conan will do when my victim hands the globe of Yazood to the chief of Khurum." Back before the hut, Yar Afzal halted in the midst of some tirade, surprised and displeased to see the man he had sent up the valley pushing his way through the throng. "I bade you go to the Watchers," the chief bellowed. "You have not had time to come from them." The other did not reply. He stood woodenly, staring vacantly into the chief's face, his palm outstretched holding the jade ball. Conan, looking over Yar Afzal's shoulder, murmured something and reached to touch the chief's arm, but as he did so, Yar Afzal, in a paroxysm of anger, struck the man with his clenched fist and felled him like an ox. As he fell, the jade sphere rolled to Yar Afzal's foot, and the chief, seeming to see it for the first time, bent and picked it up. The men, staring perplexedly at their senseless comrade, saw their chief bend, but they did not see what he picked up from the ground. Yar Afzal straightened, glanced at the jade, and made a motion to thrust it into his girdle. "Carry that fool to his hut," he growled. "He has the look of a lotus eater. He returned me a blank stare. In his right hand, moving toward his girdle, he had suddenly felt movement where movement should not be. His voice died away as he stood and glared at nothing, and inside his clenched right hand he felt the quivering of change, of motion, of life. He no longer held a smooth, shining sphere in his fingers, and he dared not look. His tongue clove to the roof of his mouth, and he could not open his hand. His astonished warriors saw Yar Afzal's eyes distend, the color ebb from his face. Then, suddenly, a bellow of agony burst from his bearded lips. He swayed and fell, as if struck by lightning, his right arm tossed out in front of him. Face down he lay, and from between his opening fingers crawled a spider, a hideous, black, hairy-legged monster whose body shone like black jade. The men yelled and gave back suddenly, and the creature scuttled into a crevice of the rocks and disappeared. The warriors started up, glaring wildly, and a voice rose above their clamor. A far-carrying voice of command, which came from none knew where. Afterward, each man there, who still lived, denied that he had shouted, but all there heard it. "Yar Afzal is dead! Kill the Outlander!" That shout focused their whirling minds as one. Doubt, bewilderment, and fear vanished in the uproaring surge of the bloodlust. A furious yell rent the skies as the tribesmen responded instantly to the suggestion. They came headlong across the open space, cloaks flapping, eyes blazing, knives lifted. Conan's action was as quick as theirs. As the voice shouted, he sprang for the hut door, but they were closer to him than he was to the door, and with one foot on the sill he had to wheel and parry the swipe of a yard-long blade. He split the man's skull, ducked another swinging knife and gutted the wielder, felled a man with his left fist and stabbed another in the belly, and heaved back mightily against the closed door with his shoulders. Hacking blades were nicking chips out of the jams about his ears, but the door flew open under the impact of his shoulders, and he went stumbling backward into the room. A bearded tribesman, thrusting with all his fury as Conan sprang back, overreached and pitched headfirst through the doorway. Conan stopped, grasped the slack of his garments and hauled him clear, and slammed the door in the faces of the men who were struggling into it. Bones snapped under the impact, and the next instant Conan slammed the bolts into place and whirled with desperate haste to meet the man who sprang from the floor and tore into action like a madman. Yasmina, cowering in a corner, staring in horror as the two men fought back and forth across the room, almost trampling her at times. The flash and clangor of their blades filled the room, and outside the mob clamored like a wolf pack, hacking deafeningly at the bronze door with their long knives and dashing huge rocks against it. Somebody fetched a tree trunk, and the door began to stagger under the thunderous assault. Yasmina clasped her ears, staring wildly. Violence and fury within, cataclysmic madness without. The stallion in his stall neighed and reared, thundering with his heels against the walls. He wheeled and launched his hoofs through the bars just as the tribesmen, backing away from Conan's murderous swipes, stumbled against them. His spine cracked in three places like a rotten branch, and he was hurled headlong against the Cimmerian, bearing him backward so that they both crashed to the beaten floor. Yasmina cried out and ran forward. To her dazed sight, it seemed that both were slain. She reached them just as Conan threw aside the corpse and rose. She caught his arm, trembling from head to foot.
"Oh, you live! I thought you were dead."
He glanced down at her quickly, into the pale, upturned face and the wide, staring dark eyes.
"Why are you trembling?" he demanded. "Why should you care if I live or die?"
A vestige of her poise returned to her, and she drew away, making a rather pitiful attempt at playing the Devi. "You were preferable to those wolves howling without," she answered, gesturing toward the door, the stone sill of which was beginning to splinter away.
"That won't hold long," he muttered, then turned and went swiftly to the stall of the stallion.
Yasmina clenched her hands and caught her breath as she saw him tear aside the splintered bars and go into the stall with the maddened beast. The stallion reared above him, neighing terribly, hoofs lifted, eyes and teeth flashing and ears laid back. But Conan leaped and caught his mane with a display of sheer strength that seemed impossible, and dragged the beast down on his forelegs. The steed snorted and quivered, but stood still while the man bridled him and clapped on the gold-worked saddle with the wide silver stirrups. Wheeling the beast around in the stall, Conan called quickly to Yasmina, and the girl came, sidling nervously past the stallion's heels. Conan was working at the stone wall, talking swiftly as he worked.
"A secret door in the wall here that not even the Wazuli know about. Yar Afzal showed it to me once when he was drunk. It opens out into the mouth of the ravine behind the hut. Ha!"
As he tugged at a projection that seemed casual, a whole section of the wall slid back on oiled iron runners. Looking through, the girl saw a narrow defile opening in a sheer stone cliff within a few feet of the hut's back wall. Then Conan sprang into the saddle and hauled her up before him. Behind them, the great door groaned like a living thing and crashed in, and a yell rang to the roof as the entrance was instantly flooded with hairy faces and knives in hairy fists. And then the great stallion went through the wall like a javelin from a catapult, and thundered into the defile, running low, foam flying from the bit rings. That move came as an absolute surprise to the Wazuli. It was a surprise, too, to those stealing down the ravine. It happened so quickly, the hurricane-like charge of the great horse, that a man in a green turban was unable to get out of the way. He went down under the frantic hoofs, and a girl screamed. Conan got one glimpse of her as they thundered by, a slim dark girl in silk trousers and a jeweled breastband, flattening herself against the ravine wall. Then the black horse and his riders were gone up the gorge like the spume blown before a storm, and the men who came tumbling through the wall into the defile after them met that which changed their yells of bloodlust to shrill screams of fear and death. End of chapter 5.